Myself Shweta Shah. I'm your instructor for the subject Computer Organization and Architecture. In this subject, we have started Unit 5, that is Central Processing Unit. In this unit, we are going to see today the topic, that is subroutine call and return, and we also see the intro. So let me start with the topic, that is subroutine and call return. The subroutine is a self-contained sequence of instructions that performs a given computational task. During the execution of a program, a subroutine may be called to perform its function many times at the various points in the main program whenever it required. It is like a function in C language. So, a call subroutine instruction is a consist of an operation code together with the address that specifies the beginning of the subroutine. The instruction is executed by performing two major operations. These are the address of the next instruction that is available in the program counter, or you can say that is the return address, is required to be stored at the temporary location so that the subroutine knows where to return. Okay, first thing will be this, that it should have to store the return address, and then control is transferred to the beginning of the subroutine, and the last instruction of the every subroutine, commonly called as a return from the subroutine, that will transfers the return address from the temporary location into the program counter. This results in the transfer of the program control to the main program. So two tasks are required. First one is the, when you are transferring to the subroutine, you have to store your next instruction's address, and when you are returning from the subroutine, you have to return to the main program. So these are the two major tasks which are required. The different computer uses different temporary locations for the storing of the return address. Some stores the return address in the first memory location of the subroutine, some stores it at a fixed location in the memory, some stores it in the processor registers, and some stores this in a stack memory. So we can use any of this method to the store of your return address. A subroutine call is implemented with the following micro operation. If you are using the stack operation or stack memory, then first you require to store the return address. So for storing the return address, if we consider that you have used a memory stack, then you have to decrement the stack pointer by one so that you can store at the top of the stack. Then at that location that is given by stack pointer, you have to store the program counter. And then lastly, you have to change the effective address where your subroutine is stored, that is required to be stored into program counter, so that new location where you have stored your subroutine, from that location your instructions can be executed. This is the task when you are calling any subroutine. When you are returning from the subroutine, you will require that you store the top of the stack, that is your program counter, to the program counter so that you can return to the main program. And next you will require to change the stack pointer by incrementing it so that your stack is empty by one location. So by this way, when you are calling subroutine, you have to store your program counter. When you are returning from the subroutine, you have to pop up your stack, pop up your program counter from the stack. So by this way, you can do subroutine call and return. Next, we will see the program interrupt. The concept of program interrupt is used to handle a variety of problems that arise out of the normal program sequence. The program interrupt refers to the transfer of the program control from currently running program to the another service program as a result of an external or internally generated request. The control returns to the original program after servicing program is executed. So this is also one kind of subroutine and subroutine call and return. The interrupt procedure quite similar to the subroutine call But there is some exception, and these exceptions are the interrupts are usually initiated by internal or external signal rather than the execution of the instruction, except the software interrupt that we will discuss later on. So these interrupts are generated by some external signal rather than the internal one. Second difference is that this address of the interrupt service program is determined by the hardware rather than from the address field in the instruction. And third difference is that in interrupt procedure, usually we require to store all of the information that is necessary to define the status of CPU rather than storing only program counter, which we have stored in the subroutine call and return. So these are the three major difference between subroutine call and this program interrupt. So there is one requirement. What we have said that before jumping to the interrupt, you have to store the status of the CPU. The status of the CPU generally represented by this program status word. So let me see what is PSW, program status word. The collection of all status bit condition in the CPU is sometimes called as a program status word, or you can also see it as a PSW. The PSW is stored in a separate hardware register and contains the status information that characterize the status of the CPU. Typically, it includes the status bits from the last ALU operation, and it specifies the interrupts that are allowed to occur and whether the CPU operating in a supervisor mode or a user. Typically, this information are stored in the PSW. So, when the CPU is executing program that are the part of this operating system, it is known as a to be in a supervisor mode or in a system mode. Certain instructions are privileged and can be executed in this mode only. The CPU is normally in a user mode when we are executing the user programs. The mode that CPU operating at any given time is determined from the special status bit that you have used in a PSW. Okay, next we will see further in program interrupt. After a program has been interrupted and service routine has been executed for that interrupt, the CPU must return to the exactly same state that it was when the interrupt occurred. The state of the CPU at the end of the execution cycle is determined from one, that is the content of your program counter, second, the content of your processor register, and third, the content of certain status condition. So these three things should be actually returned to the same state when the interrupt was occurred. So these three things are required to be stored. Next, we will see the type of the interrupts. There are three major types of interrupt that cause a break in a normal execution of the program. They can be classified as an external interrupt or internal interrupt or a software interrupt. First, we will see the external interrupt. This external interrupt comes from the input-output device or from a timing device or from a circuit that is monitoring the power supply or from some external other source. Okay, so this is totally externally initiated task. The example that causes the external interrupts are IO devices requesting transfer of data, IO devices finishing transfer of the data, elapsed time of event, or the power failure. The timeout interrupt may result from the program that is in an endless loop and thus exceeded its time allocation. The power failure interrupt may have as its service routine in a program that transfer the complete state of the CPU into non-destructive memory in few milliseconds before the power ceases. Okay, so these are your external interrupt and how you can use them. Next one is an internal interrupt, or you can also abbreviate it as a trap interrupt. Internal interrupt arises from the illegal or errorsome use of some instruction or data. Internal interrupts are also known as a trap. The example of the interrupt caused by the internal error conditions are the resistor overflow or attempt to divide by zero or invalid operation code or stack overflow or protection violation. Anything can be case for the generation of this internal interrupt. The service program that processes the internal interrupts determine the corrective measures that are to be taken to change that their problem that is caused by this internal interrupt. So, the difference between the internal interrupt and external interrupt is that the internal interrupt is initiated by some exceptional conditions caused by program itself rather than the external event, while the external interrupts are generated by some external device. Internal interrupts are synchronous with the program, while internal interrupts are asynchronous. That means when you have executed some instruction and that is wrong, and at that time if that interrupt is generated, that means whenever you will execute that code, at that time for that instruction the same internal interrupt is going to be executed. Okay, while in external interrupt it is not the case, because external interrupt is initiated by some external hardware. If the program rerun and the internal interrupt will occur the same place as we have this. Next we will see the software interrupt. A software interrupt is initiated by executing an instruction. Software interrupt is a special call instruction that behaves like interrupt rather than a subroutine call. It can be used by programmer to initiate an interrupt procedure at any desired point in the program. The most common use of software interrupt is associated with the supervisor call instruction. This instruction provides means for switching this CPU from the user mode to the supervisor mode. Okay, so we can use this software interrupt for this task. Certain operations in computer may be assigned to the supervisor mode only. For example, complex input or output transfer procedure. A program written by user must run in the user mode. When an input or output transfer is required, the supervisor mode is requested by means of this supervisor call instruction, or you can say software interrupt. So this instruction causes a software interrupt that stores an old CPU status and brings the new PSW that belongs to that supervisor mode. So here we are ending our today's session. If you have any query, then you can contact me.